Greetings and welcome to the channel. My name is Videosyncratic, and as I'm sure many of you will have heard of by now, Man of Medan is the latest interactive horror game from Supermassive Games, perhaps most famous for their first entry into the genre with Until Dawn in 2015. So far, the horror games produced by Supermassive share certain hallmark touches which help to give their work a distinctive feel. Some of these similarities include the use of fixed camera angles, a photorealistic graphic style utilizing extensive motion capture, and branching storylines with multiple endings resulting as consequence of the player's choices throughout the game. Another feature Man of Medan shares with Until Dawn is the use of elements of real-life folklore as inspiration. While Until Dawn made extensive use of the Wendigo, cannibalistic spirits from Algonquian folklore, Man of Medan instead uses tales of a supposed real-life ghost ship named the Ourang Medan as inspiration for its narrative. It is the Ourang Medan and the mystery surrounding it that is the primary concern of this video. Originally, I intended uncovering the urban legend and how elements of it were taken and used in Man of Medan. However, it has already been covered by several other channels, such as the Infographics Show and Bedtime Stories. I also would like to give special mention to The Professional, who released a mini-documentary about this exact topic earlier in September. Links to all of these videos can be found in the description below. While the general overview of the myth has been quite extensively covered, from what I have seen, most reporting the tale of the Ourang Medan take a credulous point of view. Thus, I have decided to lay out my argument for why the original story of the Ourang Medan is very likely a hoax, and bring to light some oft-overlooked pieces of evidence in support of this. However, before I do this, I feel that I ought to give a brief rundown of the myth of the Ourang Medan so that everyone viewing this has the same frame of reference. I will also say before I do this that, like many urban legends, details tend to change between tellings, so what follows is a general version amalgamated from multiple sources. Once upon a time, in the 1940s, there was a merchant steamship named the SS Ourang Medan, sailing somewhere in the Pacific Ocean and carrying an illicit cargo. As the legend states, an unknown and terrible fate befell nearly the entire crew of the freighter, but not before it could send out one final, chilling SOS message, ending with the simple phrase, "I die." This SOS was intercepted by another vessel, often identified as the Silver Star, but when they caught up with the drifting Ourang Medan and boarded her, they found that the entire crew was already dead, with looks of absolute horror frozen onto their faces, and with their bodies already in an advanced state of decay, far advanced of what it ought to have been for only a few hours post-mortem. The crew of the rescue ship decided to tow the Ourang Medan to the nearest port. However, a fire broke out in the number 4 hold, and they had to abandon the ghost ship to sink beneath the waves, never to be seen again. The rescue vessel returned to its previous heading, the only thing to show for its detour, the tales its crew had to tell about the mysterious Ourang Medan and whatever ghastly fate befell its crew. I believe that it is worth mentioning here that, unlike similar events, paranormal explanations for what happened on the Ourang Medan are actually in the minority. Instead, many theories focus on the illicit cargo it is alleged to have been carrying. Whether this is identified as improperly stored sulfuric acid, or something altogether more exotic, such as an experimental chemical weapon, the deaths of the crew and the later fire are usually blamed on whatever substance this was. So, there you have it. The tale of the Ourang Medan isn't even an urban legend at all. It's a cautionary tale about the dangers of improperly stored hazardous materials. All joking aside, while I personally find some of the suggested chemical explanations actually quite compelling from a scientific perspective, I may even cover this more in depth in a later video, however, after reviewing the available evidence, I think it is safe to conclude that the story of the Ourang Medan, as fascinating as it may be, is a hoax. One piece of evidence often used to indicate that the SS Ourang Medan never existed is that it does not appear in Lloyd's shipping register. Furthermore, it is still yet to be found in any other shipping register, including those from the Netherlands. On the other hand, the SS Silver Star, the vessel often claimed to have picked up the legendary doomed SOS message, was certainly a real ship. However, by the late 1940s, when this incident is alleged to have taken place, it had already been acquired by a Brazilian corporation and renamed to the SS Santa Cecilia. In addition to this, at this point in time it mostly sailed the waters around Brazil, on a completely different ocean to where it is supposed to have been. I acknowledge that, while highly credible, these pieces of evidence are not entirely watertight. It is not completely implausible that a merchant freighter, especially one carrying an illicit cargo, could change its name while in international waters, much in the same way that smugglers change the flag they fly under to this day. However, there is a very important piece of evidence that suggests the entire story is a fabrication, but to explain that, I will first need to examine how the story has been transmitted to the present day. As related in most sources, the first mention of the Ourang Medan is stated to have been in a Dutch language newspaper called De Lemme Kortief. This paper was a trade and advertising newspaper published in Semarang, Central Java. The paper ran a series of three articles in the February and March of 1948 on the strange case of the Ourang Medan, which it evocatively referred to as a mystery of the sea. The first mention of the case in English is generally asserted to have taken place in the May of 1952 in the proceedings of the Merchant Marine Council of the United States Coast Guard. However, this is not true. The mystery of the Ourang Medan was actually reported in the November of 1940, 7 years before the incident was later alleged to have taken place. These first reports were made in two British newspapers, namely the Daily Mirror and the Yorkshire Evening Post. While some of the details of these stories differ from what would later be written, many stay the same. Perhaps most strikingly, the lack of wounds on the bodies of the crew and the eventual destruction of the ship via explosion. Both of these newspapers received this story from the New York-based Associated Press, one of the largest news agencies in the world. Thus, it was likely that the originator of the story sold it to the Associated Press, and from there it was picked up by the two British newspapers already mentioned. The question is, from whom did the Associated Press receive this story, and did they try their hand again in the late 1940s? In every published article, including the earlier ones from British newspapers, the origin of the story is linked to the Italian port city of Trieste. The name Silvio Shirley is first mentioned in De Lemme Kortief. He is alleged to have received the story from a missionary, who in turn met the sole surviving crew member of the Ourang Medan. Ignoring for the moment that this is already a third-hand account, it would appear that Silvio Shirley was a real person, likely a commercial agent active in Trieste, who wrote an article on export trade in 1959. It is this link to Trieste that very strongly suggests the earlier articles were also provided by Silvio Shirley. The repeated mention of this city is the source of these stories, makes it too unlikely for this to be mere coincidence. What could have made Shirley try to sell his story again, 7 years after his original attempt was taken up? One theory put forward by the Scottish Library, whose excellent and criminally overlooked blog post on the Ourang Medan made this video possible, was that the story Shirley originally sold to the Associated Press in 1940 simply didn't generate as much attention as he had hoped for, and so he tried his luck once more after the big distraction, generally known as the Second World War, had ended, and with a few more embellishments added. This time, the story stuck, and it's still going even to this day. This interpretation may also help to explain why the location of the incident is so susceptible to change between different versions. In the earliest articles from 1940, the Ourang Medan sank in the Solomon Islands. In De la Mokotif, it was instead in the Marshall Islands where the vessel met its fate. However, this pales in comparison to later tellings, where it had become displaced still further into the Straits of Malacca, over 10,000 kilometers away from the Marshall Islands. If one assumes that these are later embellishments by Sylvia Shirley, one possible explanation for this is that its location has slowly been changed over the years to better fit the name of the ship. Ourang Medan can literally be taken to mean Man of Medan, with Ourang meaning person or man in Malay, and as seen in words such as orangutan, meaning man of the forest, and Medan being the largest city of Sumatra, a city located on the Straits of Malacca. While I think the evidence I have mentioned so far speaks for itself in proving that the case of the Ourang Medan was fabricated all along, I would like to briefly mention the alleged involvement of the CIA and rebut why I don't think this gives the story any additional credibility. In 2003, a letter sent to the CIA was released to the public for the first time. This letter, which inquired about the Ourang Medan, was sent in the December of 1959 by a Mr. C.H. Mark Jr., whom I assume to have been a private citizen of Arizona. While the letter has been sanitized, and the recipient of the letter removed, this is standard practice for removing identifying personal information, besides which, the addressee of the letter can easily be concluded from both the contents of the letter and the reply to it, the reply being released in 2002. The intended recipient of the letter was Alan Dulles, the then director of Central Intelligence, responsible for the CIA. Thus, the letter can be categorized as a letter of concern from a private citizen to the public director of a government body about something they believe that public body should be made aware of. The reply the CIA sent back to Mark was very non-specific, and reads much like a stock response. It is hardly evidence for any involvement in the case of the Ourang Medan, and it barely seems to have aroused any attention from that quarter at all. With all the evidence I have laid out, I think it is safe to conclude that the story of the Ourang Medan is a hoax, and was in fact fabricated from the very beginning. The fact that very nearly the same story is reported 7 years prior to the most commonly alleged date of the incident, alongside the Trieste connection, strongly suggests that Sylvia Shirley made up the story and attempted to sell it to the press on two separate occasions. The lack of any reference to the ship in any registry only serves to add fuel to this fire. As the old saying definitely doesn't go, while all roads may not lead to Rome, the Ourang Medan will always lead back to Trieste. Whether you agree with me or still need some convincing, the story of the Ourang Medan is certainly a compelling one, regardless of its veracity, and I hope you will all agree that without stories like these, the world would be a slightly duller place. To everyone who stayed until this point of the video, thank you so much for doing so, as it truly means a great deal to me, especially with this being my first video. Once again, I would like to give special thanks to Estelle from the Skittish Library for their fantastic blog post on the Ourang Medan. If you are interested in reading a bit more about the case, then I definitely recommend it as a place to start. You can check it out through the link in the description below. I would also like to give mention to the British Newspaper Archive, as without their tireless efforts, articles like those previously mentioned would doubtless be lost to the ages. Finally, if you like this video, then please leave a like, and I would love to hear what you may have to say in the comments below. If this content is just what you've been looking for, then please also consider subscribing and clicking the bell to receive notifications. After all, you never know what might come next. That's all from me for now. Thank you so much again for watching, and I hope to see you again in the next video. Until then, ciao.